I'm going to be telling you tonight. About 20 years ago, I moved to Lamont, and it's very different from much of the Chicago area. And I'll be showing you why in a moment. But I got very interested in it, and I kept on seeing as I drove around things like Saganaski Slough, St. James at Sag Bridge. And the word SAG just kind of stuck in my head. So what is that about? What does this mean? So I started asking people. Nobody really knew. After a period of time, I got involved with the Lamont Historical Society, and I thought, I'm going to find this out. So I started asking there, and they said, well, you know, there used to be a place here called Sag Bridge, but there really isn't anything anymore. I said, well, why isn't there? And nobody knew. Where is it? Well, it's in this corner of Lamont. And so I basically said, well, don't we have information about that? Shouldn't we? I mean, if it's part of Lamont, shouldn't the Historical Society have some information about Sag Bridge? They said, that's great. You want to do it. So the bottom line is, out of my interest, I started doing a number of things and found out a lot about Sag Bridge, and I'm here to tell you some of that tonight. So where is it exactly? Well, if you're going south on Route 83, you come to basically Archer. There are a series of bridges, and then Route 83 makes a hard turn and it goes east. And right there is where there once was a town. Mm-hmm. And in that town, there was a hotel, a tavern, a post office, a general store, school district, fire department, a train station, a stop on the trolley or electric streetcar, and a port. <coughs> 13,000 years ago, we're going way back, why is this area significant? There was a place called, Lake Michigan was a much larger lake and was called Lake Chicago. This is what it looks like, and you also have it in your handouts. Right around, well, this is Blue Island, okay. Right around through here is where LaGrange Road would have been. Okay. This is roughly Keene. What? I'm sorry. LaGrange Road would be right here. In between this area was a taller area, which was that was termed in long ago terms, Mount Forest Island. Okay. That today is basically the Palos Forest Preserves. Almost all of that island is the Palos Forest Preserve. What happened is that when Lake Chicago drained, the waters poured through here and they went towards the Illinois River and ultimately poured into the Illinois River. The amount of water that flowed through there when the outlet broke would have dwarfed Niagara Falls. It was just a tremendous amount of water. Of course, no one was here to see it because it was 13,000 years ago. At that time, you wouldn't have seen, I mean, this is where the Chicago River is now. Okay, a little piece over here. The Des Plaines River now comes down here. And on either side of this area where the island is, there were two valleys that were formed. This is the Des Plaines River Valley, and this is the Sag Valley. Now the term sag, I found out what that means is, it's the opposite of a bluff. When you have a geographical feature that goes up to a higher area is called a bluff. If you have one that goes down, it's called a sag. So this was the Sag Valley, and it was mostly swamp. And this is the Des Plaines Valley, And this is why, when you drive into Chicago, say you're taking the Stevenson Expressway down, you can actually, if you pay attention, you can see how it's higher until you get to a little bit east of LaGrange Road, and then it smooths out. So that's where the valleys are. So Sag Bridge was right here. It was in kind of sort of the swampy area. This is the tip of the island. On the island is St. James at Sag Bridge. So that's the areas that we're talking about today. That's where they came from. Today, all that's there is a cluster of homes and industry. The houses are no longer there. The only thing that's really still there is the old church, St. James at Sag Bridge, which we'll talk about more too. The area was settled, as almost all of the Chicago area was settled, about 1830. It was in 1818 that Illinois became a state. They couldn't really sell land or settle land until they had everything mapped and plotted out. So nothing too much happened. It was mostly Indians before it became a state. When it became a state, then they still had some other things to take care of. They had to settle treaties with the Indians and be sure that the land was actually available for settlement. So it was right around 1830. So if you go to, you know, Oaklawn, or you go to Downers Grove, or just about any other suburbs, you'll find most of them probably started somewhere between about 1830 and 1838 or 1840, the earliest ones. So in 1840, this is where the town of Sag Bridge was already, and you see it was all plotted out because this map was actually drawn in 1840. Can you see that from back there? It looks kind of...
No.
It's okay. Yeah, it's not... I mean, these are old maps, so it's not really that easy to see anyway. These marks, by the way, are the bluffs. So this is the north bluff of the Des Plaines Valley. And then right here, with those little hash marks, as if those are Mount Forest Island again. So that's showing the higher land there. 100 years later, now we've got roads, we've got much, much more. Here's there. The most Sag Bridge was right in this area. At that time, although there was a bridge crossing at Route 83, there was also another bridge that crossed at Archer Avenue, because Archer Avenue went straight. Now those roads go together. They don't any longer. And then there's a little area right in here. Those are quarries. Sag quarries. This is off of Google Maps. This is, you know, what the area is today. So prior to the early 1830s, it was mostly Indians that were here. They established the villages and the trails. They liked it because they could go onto the bluffs and they could see from Mount Forest Island, they could see down just about every direction. They could see down the Sag Valley, they could see down the Des Plaines Valley in both directions. So they had a really good shot. They also, on the North Bluff, they had a high area that they called Signal Mountain, because that's where they would signal from. And when they signaled from that area, again, they could be seen by the residents, no matter which side of the valley you were on or which valley you were in, they could all be seen from the same point. So it was strategically a very great place for them. Consequently, when when the explorers came through the area, and they came here as early as the 1600s. Pierre Marquette was here in 1673. So there were also some French forts that were built on the island. This is, historians like this map because this one shows where the Indian villages were. And again, there were many of them that went, they followed the river and on the island. The villages are marked by the little teepee-like structures and the little cone-like structures that are there. The trails, Archer Avenue, was developed from an old Indian trail. They didn't cross anybody's water at the time because they stayed on this side of the Des Plaines River. Archer Avenue did, and there was another Portage Trail and Sauk Trail. They all stayed on this side of the Des Plaines River, so they didn't have to have any bridges. They could cross by canoe if they wanted to, but they didn't really need bridges because they weren't crossing any bodies of water. Why are there three bridges there today? Well, because you have the I&M Canal, you have the Sanitary Canal, you have the CalSag, and the river. So there's much more here now because we put it here, but it wasn't here back when the Indians were here. So Archer Avenue basically would have gone into Chicago, and it went near where the Chicago Portage originally or eventually went, and then the Portage Trail went towards Indiana and Calumet. After the War of 1812, there were soldiers here, and they saw what was here. It was crowded in the east. They thought, this looks like a great place, so why don't we move here afterwards? I'll go back and get our family, and we're going to come here. It's open land. And it's available. So back when Pierre Marquette and Louis Joliet were here, they thought of the idea of putting in a canal to connect the Great Lakes to the Mississippi River, which is what it eventually did. That was the I&M Canal. So that was mulled over in Washington for a long, long time. And they knew for a long, long time that they wanted to build it, and they had sent out surveyors, and they had sent out explorers, and they had mapped it out long, long ago, all the way back to the days of Jefferson. So in they knew the first thing that they wanted to do and negotiate with the Indians was along that path. And guess what was right along that path? Sag Ridge. By 1827, the land had been divided up and by survey. And this is what that looked like. This is an 1827 survey map of the land. If you can see the Des Plaines River, the lines look really weird, and the lines are looking that weird because there's a whole big irregular island right in the middle of it. Is dividing and going around an island. None of that is there anymore. As a matter of fact, the river isn't even quite in the same place anymore because when they built the Sanitary Canal, they moved it. And they put the Sanitary Canal where the river was, and they moved the river a little bit further over. Most of this area in here was swamp. Because a great deal of the Sag Valley was swampy. So, land sales were started in 1835. Sag Ridge was not the only one of these little towns that were cropping up all over the place because they needed some hubs of activity, having them 10 miles apart, 15 miles apart, wasn't very convenient, so they were closer together. So these were some towns that still in the same general area. Des Plaines actually eventually was called Sag Ridge. At one time was called Des Plaines, then later became Sag Ridge. The other towns, Haytown, are gone. Lamont was originally called Athens because of the stone that comes from their Athens marble, they called it, the quarry. There was a was very popular were classical things and classical names that this during this period of time, that's what people liked. And so Athens was a classical type of name. The town of Romeoville was actually originally called Romeo, and the town of Joliet was originally called Juliet. So we had Romeo and Juliet and Athens all in that same area. People sometimes know about the Romeoville part, but not so much about the Juliet. They just assumed it was named for Louise Joliet, which everybody would say now that it was, but before it was that, it was Julia. It's very similar. By 1851, the population of kind of a combination Athens, Des Plaines, was about 336. Mostly farmers. By 1862, Sag Ridge alone had almost 1,000 residents and was larger than Lamont. Now, why would that be? That would be because a lot of the people who came to dig the canal gathered in the Sag Ridge area. Housing was rather poor. We'll get into a little more of the details of that, but it was a more convenient place for them to be. They were around, most of them were Irish, and so they clustered together among the other Irish residents. But you can see, this is the representative size of Sag Ridge. This is the representative size of Lamont. So it was significantly bigger at that time. It's about 3.5 miles between the two. By the turn of the century, Lamont was beginning to grow and Sag Ridge was starting to decline. There's a number of reasons for that. The Sanitary Canal was in operation then, transportation was much better. People could get to anywhere that they wanted to go more easily. The canal hadn't been dug before then, but it was dug by 1900, and it displaced some of the area. The Calsag later displaced even more. I know I'm showing a lot of maps here, but they'll end, believe me. We'll get done with those soon. This is right around 1900, and now the new feature that we have is that the Des Plaines River is now straight, and we've got Calsag, which is next to it. That island's all gone, and you've got roads. Kind of a different picture because now you have more waterways. Lamont is the only place that has all four of the waterways that are instrumental to the building of Chicago. Before the I&M Canal, Chicago's population was maybe about 300. It was very, very small. There wasn't any reason for it to grow because there was no way to transport things from one place to another. Why would you want to have a farm and produce merchandise to sell to someone when you didn't have any transportation or any way to get it there? Okay. And why would anybody want to come and bring things to Chicago when once they got there, there was no place for them to go? So by opening up that path of the I&M Canal, it just made everything change. Because now people could go from place to place. There was a reason for it to be there, a reason for merchandise to come there. So that's what did that. So it was in 1673 that Father Marquette came through, saw the potential. They authorized the I&M Canal in 1822, and then it was constructed between the years of 1836 and 1848. That was what brought the big population into the Sag Bridge and Lamont areas because they needed workers for the canal. Then, the first canal, it did a lot of things, but what it didn't do very well is it didn't handle, it didn't always fill, so there were periods of time when they couldn't really get things from place to place because the water wasn't sufficient to for them to maneuver up and down the canal. So they needed to have feeders. They tried a number of things. Feeders didn't really work. Sanitation was very poor because everybody dumped everything into the canal. There was nowhere for it to go, and so it just stayed there. People were getting sick, so they had to do something. So they decided that they were going to build a sanitary canal. And they finished the Lamont section of that in, well, they opened it in 1900. They finished the section around Sag Bridge in 1895. That was a big improvement, but it still didn't work as well. They still didn't have enough water going into it, so that's when they had to build the Cal Sag, and that was constructed between 1911 and 1922 and finished in 1922. So all of these waterways, the I&M, where I showed you the peak of that Mount Forest Island, okay, well, through the Sag Valley is where the Cal Sag runs, through the Des Plaines Valley is where the Des Plaines River runs, and the Sanitary Canal and the I&M Canal. So all four of them are joining together at where Sag Bridge was. So who lives there? Canal workers, of course. Many Irish immigrants. The homes were poor. They probably were more termed as shanties or shacks than they were homes. Many of them, but not all of them. In the surrounding area, there were farmers and there were business owners. The earliest resident was Joshua Bell. You know Bell Road, that was named after him. He lived at what would have been about 125th and where Bell Road is now. That was where he originally lived. He established an inn, store, tavern, post office, and grew up around that. They called it sometimes Sag Station as well as Sag Bridge. It was known by both names for a period of time. This is his son, William. Actually, Joshua didn't stay around all that long. He was here maybe 10 or 15 years, and then he moved on. But his son, William, decided to stay in the area, and that's William's wife, Therese. This was what their home looked like, typical 1900s kind of home, or 1900 kind of home, turn of the century kind of home. Can't quite figure, it looks still like they're playing croquet. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. This one looks like to me. In 1878, Lamont had 52 businesses, Sag Bridge had 12. Of the 52 businesses in Lamont, 17 of them were saloons. Two were what they called hotels. Hotels probably weren't what you think of as a hotel now. It was more like a boarding house. Or maybe it was someone that just had an extra room in their house. And so they opened up, rented it to someone on a longer term basis. It wasn't like an overnight stay type. Sag Bridge only had one saloon, but it was kind of odd because there were a lot of single male workers in Sag Bridge, so you would have thought that most of the saloons would be there go to Sag Bridge during this period of time is because they had prize fights there. And Jimmy Barry was the world middleweight champion. I don't know an awful lot about prize fighting, so I'm not sure what all the weights were. One of the lighter ones, at any rate. And was from the area. In fact, the championship fight was fought at Sag Bridge. One of the reasons that it was that was done is because there were a lot of Irish in the Bridgeport area who were very interested in fights. In Chicago, prize fighting was illegal. So instead, they had it in Sag Bridge, and they could just get on the canal, one of the barges on the canal in Bridgeport, shoot on down the canal to Sag Bridge, and see their fights. It was illegal in Sag Bridge too, but they did it anyway. So what kind of businesses were there? Those were the business owners at that period of time, and those were the types of businesses that they had. And you can read them off of the note, or off of the board. The one that sits there in red, Alexander Reed, actually is kind of interest, because Alexander Reed, according to, and I'm not going to swear by this because I don't know this is true, I'm just saying that people say this is true. It's documented in a couple of places. Alexander Reed was actually in partnership in Lamont with Marsha Field. And Marsha Field said, you know, I'm going to go to Chicago because I think that's a much better place to sell merchandise. And Alexander Reed said, you're crazy. We got a great business here at Sag Bridge. You just really ought to stay here. I know how all that turned out. Two of the owners you say they were quarries. And quarries were very popular or very important to Lamont. When they were digging the canal, it was very difficult because Lamont is over a bed of limestone, and so they had to dig through that, but by the time they got the canal dug, they realized that there was a market for the stone. And the stone from Lamont, in the Lamont area, is different from many others because it has a yellowish cast that was very popular at the time. Holy Name Cathedral is built from Lamont stone. The Chicago Water Tower is built from Lamont stone. If you go to a number of buildings, of course, in Lamont are also built from Lamont stone. So it was very important because they made a lot of money off of it. And when they were digging the canal workers were not, sometimes they ran out of money and they didn't have, they couldn't give them salaries. So they gave them pieces of paper called scrip. And the scrip they could use to trade in on land after the canal was dug. And so some of them bought farms and stayed. Some of them sold their scrip to other people who used it to buy farms and stay. And some of them bought the quarry land and the quarry. So that was basically where the area came from. There's a picture of some of the quarry workers in 1889. It's along Main Street into Lamont. The thing that struck me when I looked at this, this is another picture too. I expected these men to be young and burly. But they don't look young and burly to me. They look kind of average and kind of 40-ish, maybe.
They just look
I thought that was a little surprising. size of that. Steam shovel. Another thing that they found is there were a lot of fossils in this stone. This particular one, you tend to think of fossils as being little things like this. This one's about this size. Cephalopod. Cephalopod is, they were related to today's octopi, I guess that's the plural, and squid. I talked about the sanitary canal, and we see it now, it's just there, and it doesn't seem to be very important to us. You see the barges going up and down. But this was a real marvel. Starting with the quarries, I showed you the machinery for a reason, because it was designed to work in those quarries. So when they decided that they needed to dig the canal and move the river and all that business, which was, by the way, they termed that the Chicago School of Earth Moving, that's what they called it at the time. Machinery was then readapted to make the sanitary canal, construct the sanitary canal. During that construction, that same machinery was then used to build the Panama Canal. So all of this, again, it came right out of this area. There were so many important things that came from right here. I just find it so exciting. When they were building this, the people who ran the railroads, they said, you know, this is a gold mine because this is such a marvelous thing that we're doing out here, and people will want to see that. So they ran tours. And you could come from Chicago on the train, and they would meet you with a horse and buggy, and they would take you and they would show you the equipment. And that's what you're seeing a picture of here, is people touring the quarries while it's under construction. Now, if you're really important, you might get to ride in one of those. And I, again, I'm not sure how clear everybody in the room can see this. Can you see the dog? I just thought that was really kind of entertaining as well. This is the Sag Quarry that is right below St. James Sag Bridge. Here's the steeple for St. James, and then the quarry down below. When they built St. James, they had to lug, it wasn't that quarry, it was one that was a little distance away, but they had to move it up the hill. And you can see it's a distance, and it would not have been an easy thing to do. Back around the turn of the century, when Sag Bridge was sort of kind of in its heyday, if it ever really had a heyday, their transportation was much better than the transportation we have now. In Lamont, we have three trains going downtown in the morning, one coming back in the afternoon, and two in the evening. That's it. I think you have a little bit more here in Palos Heights, but I don't think you had them every half hour, which basically, people who lived in Sag Bridge, they had some transportation going between Joliet and Chicago. One way or the other, they could get on something about every 30 minutes. You know, if it wasn't, there were two passenger trains going down, and the traffic on the canal wouldn't have been exactly that sort of thing, because it was used more for merchandise and for longer trips, so it wouldn't have been from place to place. But then there was also an electric train. So they had a lot of options, and it was pretty convenient. Here's the electric train that, when it came through Lamont, down Main Street, the and there was another staff further up closer to St. James. There were actually two staffs there. The railroads, in addition to running these tours during the canal construction, they also built a number of places for entertainment and recreation. One of them was in Lamont, it was called Alton Park. Another one was in Lockport and was called Delwood Park. And this is what it looked like. Delwood Park is still there today, but this is not there. You can still see the dam, but nothing is flowing over it. This was a pavilion where they had dances, and the train would, you could take a train from Chicago, and it would let you off right there at the park. They had bands, and you could rent canoes and rowboats, and this is what the trolley looked like. I imagine, looking around the room, that there are at least a few of you who may remember the trolley. Whether it be a ball game, a concert, dance, or fair, it's the trolley cars that bring most of the people there. The one that stopped to say, I tried to get a picture of the actual one that went through Sack Ridge, and I could not find it. I knew what it was supposed to look like. I had a description, but I just could not find that actual car. It's very like this. Would have been the same color. It would look like this in the front. Everything would have been the same, pretty much, except the doors would have been in the center instead of at both ends. That's as close as I could come. There's the interior. If you remember this, and for those of you who don't remember it, what would happen is that the trolleys didn't turn around. When you got to one end, this was duplicated on the other end. So he would just take his little key out of there, walk to the other end, plug it in on the other end, and take off and go back the other way. Similarly, these seats were made to move. They moved the backs on them. So as he went from one end to the other, he's going flip, 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 like that, moving all the seats. They were wicker, I remember. They're like a wicker. So why did Sag Ridge disappear? Well, when they diverted the canal, they actually enlarged Saganaski Slough. Put the canal through, both of those took up space, so the farms weren't being used anymore. The farmers sold off their land to the Forest Preserve District. There was better transportation, so now it was more convenient for people to go to larger centers to buy their goods. So they didn't really need them. The businesses in town weren't doing as well. And eventually it just wasn't much point of it anymore. What most people don't know is that the forest preserves out here, they're not natural forest preserves that were always here that way, because after the people came to this area, they cleared all the land and they farmed all the land. They bought all the land. So it wasn't until the forest preserves bought them shortly after the Columbian Exhibition is when they got interested and started buying up land, made most of the purchases between, say, 1910 and 1922, something like that. They then let them revert back to their natural state and encouraged them to do that. During the CCC camps during the Depression, they came out and built the lakes, the waterfalls. Those things were not there. Maple Lake, for instance, is a man-made lake. It's not a natural lake. Saganaski Slough is a man-made slough. And almost everything out there is. If you ever go to Waterfall Glen, that's a man-made waterfall. So. Before they built the Cal Sag, remember they finished that, that picture that I showed you where there was a steeple of St. James, and if you were standing basically there, that's what it would have looked like. There was no canal there, there was just this little ditch. If you look the other way, now, this bluff is Mount Forest Island. We're going down the Sag Valley. On the other side over here is like where Swallow Cliff is. It's the other bluff on the other side of the valley. After they started the Cal Sag, guess what it looked like? That's what they were doing. Now people say, what is the Sag Bridge, by the way? What is that? What? Don't really know for sure, but I think that this is what we're seeing back here. That's the Sag Bridge. And it only crossed that little bit of water that I was showing you, where it was more like a ditch than anything else. That's all it really.
Probably a toll road.
Right. Here's another view of it from another direction. And again, you can see St. James over there.
St. James was already built then?
Yes, St. James was built, and the church was started 1850-something and then finished about, I believe it was 1865. They had one room schoolhouse in Sagbridge. They had its own school district up until 1859, did not close until 1859. The one room schoolhouse was really a two room schoolhouse. Because it had an upper floor and a lower floor. And the upper grades were on the upper floor and the lower grades were on the lower floor. One school teacher. I bet she got a lot of exercise. I'm not good with specs. So what remains today is St. James. It's at that western tip. It overlooks both of the valleys. It probably was a Potawatomi Indian site at one time. There probably was a French fort there at one time. It was visited by Marquette and Joliet. Originally, there was a log cabin on the site, and it's probably the date I have there is actually a little earlier, was probably in the 30s. Today, it's still surrounded by a cemetery, surrounded by forest. It's also the site where one of my books takes place, by the way. If you like ghosts, I've got a ghost in this room. And St. James. There's a church, you see, it looks a little ghost-like. Another interesting thing about this, most of the gravestones that you see are facing east. Now, I don't know whether or not that's the situation with all cemeteries, but at St. James, that's intentional. It's because on the day of resurrection, you face the rising sun. So the parish was supposedly founded in 1833, and actually there were two Indians, Potawatomi Indians, who signed the petition to have a priest sent here. The Indians, many of them had been educated by missionaries, and many of them were Catholics, and they wanted this in their community. A lot of details there that probably aren't real interested in. We can go back to them later, but we have a few more things to cover. This is how it looked in 1906. And today, it's got paths that are blacktopped. The foliage is much more mature. That's the entrance into the church and into the graveyard. This is what it looks like on the inside. I have a close-up of this window. It's called the Eye of God window. Kind of a little freaky thing. Yeah. I could not get a good picture of this window. Even when you look back here, see, I took that picture. See how the window looks in there? I mean, does it look anything like that? It looks like a blur. I went back over and over again in all kinds of different light conditions, and every time I tried to take it is said to be haunted. There are a lot of various rumors or legends about things that happened there. The one about the horse-drawn hearse going down Archer Avenue, drawing an infant's casket that's glowing, is one of the more popular ones. Phantom Indians on horseback, they actually have a little more detail on that one, because the that came from some skeletons that they dug up. If you go there even today in the afternoon, you go to the church and it walk through that cemetery, and it seems very eerie. In 1897, they dug up some skeletons there, which were probably Indian remains. One of them was said to be over 7 feet tall. After they were dug up, people started seeing Indians on horseback during the middle of the night, running around, disappearing and appearing and disappearing. So they freaked out and they said, it's because you dug up all those skeletons, you gotta rebury them. Well, they did rebury most of them, but some of them went to the Field Museum. There's a community center as soon as you enter the property of St. James now. It once looked like that building, and so it was called the Monk's Castle because it kind of looked a little bit like a castle. And one of the more popular legends about ghosts at the place was a story about a housekeeper at the church who fell in love with the priest's assistant, and they decided they were going to elope. Well, what happened is when the wagon pulled up to get them in the middle of the night, for some reason unknown, the horses bolted and both of them were killed. So on numerous occasions since that time, people have seen this carriage, they see a woman dressed in white calling, come on, like this. One of the most popular ones was from, there were two musicians who came out because there was a fair that was given by the parish, and it didn't end until late, so they slept overnight at the Monk's Castle. This was back around early 1900s, I believe. And during the middle of the night, one of them heard horses and got up and looked and couldn't see anything. After a period of time, heard them again, but now he saw a wagon coming that disappears. And then went and woke up his friend and said, look at what's going on. They look out the window. Now the wagon comes, it doesn't disappear, and then they see a woman calling to them. And these were very reputable people who were telling these stories. This is that same legend. This is another picture of quarries. There is a theory that there are more ghostly happenings and more paranormal activity around quarries. And the reason that they say that that happens are a number of reasons, because chemical makeup of limestone is very similar to that of magnetic recording tape. That material is prone to imprint and capture and store activities with electromagnetic fields. So wherever you have quarry stone, whether it be in the original quarry or in buildings that are made from quarry stone, there would be more incidents. And it is a fact for people who have track these things, I'm repeating it, I haven't done it myself, that there are more paranormal incidents that happen wherever large amounts of limestone exist. Think about Resurrection Mary. The quarries are in this area, okay? Many Irish American canal workers, some of them were cremated and their ashes scattered over the quarries. Said that people who died violently are more likely to remain behind as spirits. American Indians lived in the Saguenay Plains valleys and had burial grounds there. These burial grounds have not been preserved traditionally according to their beliefs, so have those disturbances caused more activity. If Bachelor's Grove Cemetery, that's out in Midlothian. There's just an amazing number of experiences out there, some of which I've seen myself, but I'm not going to go into those today. Couple of buildings made from limestone with hauntings that relate to them too. The Chicago Water Tower is made of limestone. There's sightings of the Hanging Man or Lone Pumpman, who's said to be the only worker who stayed behind during the Great Fire. At Holy Name Cathedral, across the street was where Dean O'Banion was shot in a gangland sling in his flower shop. I said that the bullet holes can't be patched, the bullet holes that from that murder in the stone at St. James, they patch them and they come back. They patch them and they come back. And one other more eerie thing out there is near St. James is where the nuclear waste from the Manhattan Project is buried. So one would think, maybe not necessarily hauntings, but that the energy level might be a little bit different than it is in other places. Here we have today's Sag Bridge. This is Route 83. This is the CalSag. This is the Sanitary Canal. This Plains River Valley, Sag Valley. This is where the town of Sag Bridge was. St. James is right here. All of this, Mount Forest Island. This is, if you go down, walking in this area. This is what it's like. The CalSag actually runs right down here. But today, there are trails that go through here, bicycle trails. You can take them from near Saw Cliff. Walk all the way out along there. That's what it looks like. Right in here is where Steeple St. James is. I'm at an angle, I can't see it as well as you can. So that's the end of the formal part of my presentation. These are the books I've written. The first one is The Mystery at Sag Bridge. It's about a young woman who is killed in the graveyard there in 1898 and comes back as a ghost. The second one, The Mystery of Black Partridge Woods, takes place on the other side of the bluff near Lamont Road, and the north bluff of the river is about an Indian woman in 1817. Whose son is accused of killing a white man and has to turn into a sleuth to save her son because he has been accused of killing a white man. She's getting out of jail. So that's what my books are about, and I will have them here for sale. But right now, I will try to answer any questions you have until they kick us out. I know, I've seen them, they're ranch-type homes. They don't look like farm-style homes. So they're probably more recent than
that. Maybe like unincorporated there or anything?
Yeah, that's kind of a, some of this area, it is unincorporated. kind of strongly that this area should all be part of Lamont. But it isn't incorporated into Lamont. And there's been a little business going on right now because Kayla's Park, for various reasons, have found that they want to incorporate that land.
And who would service those residents then? Police, fire, postal?
Well, actually Lamont is still servicing that area now. Yes.
Who's Cap Sauer and what are his holdings?
You know, I don't know. That's on my to-do list though, because I'm worried about that too. Yeah.
Cap Sauer was one of the people involved in the formation and early land purchase of Cook County Forest.
Okay, great.
He was the first chairman.
That was his reward for his.
The naming rights?
Right.
Thank you. Yes.
Cap Sauer was a real taskmaster too.
Okay.
His goal that got him the Forest Preserve, that's the manager, was that he expected a full half a day's work for the whole day.
Darn you, sounds like Chicago. Yes, in the back.
A friend of mine told me that there was a Civil War prison camp in the area. More like around Red Gate.
I haven't heard that. I do know that there were quite a few people from the area that participated in the Civil War. I don't know about a camp though. I haven't heard that. Sorry. Yes?
We have someone here amongst us that lives in that cemetery.
In the cemetery?
He goes forward.
Oh! Hey, how you doing? didn't see you sneak in. Did I get any surprises tonight?
No, well done.
Okay.
The question I have, I thought I remember reading about the Fort Dearborn massacre and about the people who would come at that time when Fort Dearborn was established. And coming from Indiana and Michigan or so, they would have to go west because of the Cal Creek or river.
I don't know about that as a reason, but I do know that Black Partridge, who is an Indian chief, he didn't live in the area all the time, but he did live on that northern bluff in the Des Plaines River Valley. And he, when they had a massacre, he is the man who saved the Kinsey family. He saved about 8 people. And he brought them to the Lamont area for a period of time, a short period of time, because where they were actually, they wound up going to Indiana. But initially he brought them there. And that may have had something to do with it, that it was easier to travel that way. But there was another way of going south along there, though, on the Vincennes Trail. Because the Vincennes Trail was around, too, so I think it was more likely he just wanted to get them away to where he lived for a period of time, let things cool down, and then move them. Yes?
The name Lamont. I mean, you talked about Romeo and Juliet.
Yeah.
Lamont, and where does the Lamont and Des Plaines, where do those names come from?
Well, Des Plaines, I mean, that was named after the river, and that was, actually it's a French name, it goes back to the French explorers, and it's named after a type of maple tree that grew along the river. It was called, the Des part is, you know, just part of the French language, but it was a plain tree, P-L-A-I-N-E, tree, which is a type of maple tree that it was named after. Lamont's because there was another Athens in downstate Illinois, and the post office was getting all confused. They didn't know where to route everything. So they said, you guys change the name of your town. They said, well, let's call it Keepetaw, because Chief Keepetaw was the local chief that stayed here all the time. He wasn't a big chief, but he stayed in the area. But people thought, well, that's not a very dignified name. We don't like that very much. So they were sitting there, and a fellow got up and said, how about Lamont? His name was Lemuel. That was his first name. And they think that he used the first part of his name, Lem, and just put an aunt on it. Other people say, well, they think it probably caught on because it was like we're on a bluff. So one of the things that's unique about Lamont is it sits on a bluff overlooking the river. Where else in the Chicago area do you find it? You find it in other parts of the country, but not the Chicago area. But Lamont is. So let's say this is our mountain. Lamont, the mountain. But I think it may have been approved for that reason, but I don't think it was proposed for that reason. But anyway, we're stuck with it. We're not changing it again.
You know that dough that they have, I can't think of the name, because the Shagnasty stuck in my head. But it's that one where it's the natural doughs where they have that nature center.
Camp Sagua, right.
That's it. Is there any connection? What is that?
Well, there was a lot going on at the same time, because again, the farmers in the area weren't really doing that. It wasn't that they didn't do that well anymore, and so they were getting rid of some of the property. So part of them, some of the land was donated, for instance, to St. James. Some was sold back to the forest preserves. And so the farmhouse, that there is a farmhouse there, mm-hmm. that was originally a farmhouse, and there was originally a farm there until the forest preserves bought it. But, I mean, that's basically what happened. Shagnasty Slough was originally a much smaller, very insignificant body of water, but they kept building bigger earthen dams around it until they filled that in. And I swear the thing seems to get bigger every time I look at it. Every time I drive by it, I'm impressed all over again. I didn't remember when I first started going out there that it was. So I think it's cool. Yes?
Where is that park that
you had? Delwood Park?
Delwood?
Delwood, D-E-L-L. Yeah, if you take Archer Avenue through Lockport, as you get on the far side of the town, it's right there.
It's
a big park, yeah. And it's got a beautiful cliff there that you can walk around. It's a nice park, today. It isn't as nice as it once was. But it's still nice, and you do see the remnants of the dam so you can kind of try to envision what was there at one time. You can find that online pretty easily. Just Google Delwood Park, and you'll get all kinds of pictures of it. Yes.
When I'm driving down 83, and I see the section where all those old cars used to be, and now there's trucks there.
Yeah.
Was it dug out for limestone, or is it just the banks of the canals that they built there, or what was that land there before?
Anything that would have been dug out for limestone previously, you're going to see water in it now.
Okay.
And what happened there, they had pumps. When the quarries were operating, they were constantly cutting into springs and various other places where water would collect, and rainwater, whatever. And so they always had to pump them out. Well, when they stopped operating the quarry, there was no pump anymore, so the quarries filled up. So anytime you see a quarry that's not actively in operation now, it's going to be full of water. So you won't, you won't find just the walls.
Well, what was that land there? Because it's so low, mm-hmm. You pass over it. Was that just?
That's the valley.
That's just the valley.
It's the valley. And you know, because you go on bridges now, you lose track of that. You're thinking that when you're on the bridge that you're up, you know,
that's
land.
Yeah.
Well, it isn't land, it's bridge. And, you know, what's down below is the valley. And that, you know, that's what's really there.
Thank you.
The funny thing is with the, when they left those quarries, though, they left all the pumps and everything there. And anybody who's into scuba diving, you know, you can down, you go down there and you can see old equipment, dead cars. People like to just, you know, when they want to get rid of them, they just dump them in the quarry. So there's odd things down there. Yes, Father?
Back in the late 40s, we used to go swimming then.
Yeah. Yeah.
On a Sunday afternoon, you see cars all along Parker Ave.
Sure. Father?
Do you know any stories about the Al Capone connection with this area?
Oh, sure I do. Okay, I'll tell you the ones that are true. Al Capone did not have a home in Lamont, never did. All people have told you that he did, he didn't. However, his brother had a bottling company in Lamont, his brother Ralph, his older brother. I verified that by talking to his granddaughter. He did actually have it. He also loved tobogganing. He used to go out to Swallow Cliff. And at one time, there was a golf course that was located right off of 107th Street, right across from Saganaski Slough, that was operated by the Forest Preserve District. And that he used to golf there. Now, I can't tell you that this story happened there, but I can tell you another story. When he was pulling a club out of his bag one time, he shot himself in the foot because it dislodged a gun that he had in the bag. He was not a very good golfer, but he loved the game. And and he used to come out to Lamont and golf, and his brother ran a bottling company there. So that's about all that I know about the Capone connection. Do you know more?
Yeah?
Yeah?
Well, I've been walking through those trails there, and you can still see reminiscence of the old clubhouse. They're still
there.
And every now and then on a trail, you'll see old pipes which cross the trail, which are probably for the sprinklers.
If any of you are on Facebook, there's a site on Facebook called Exploring Mount Forest. And the site is put up by a bunch of men who bike those trails. They do mountain biking on all those trails. And they've done films, they've done a lot of research about the golf course and everything all over Mount Forest Island. It's a wealth of information, so check it out sometime. I think you'll really enjoy it. Just snoop around, there's all kinds of stuff on there.
One last interesting story about Al Capone. His lawyer was always getting him off the hook, and finally didn't, and got killed himself. His son went into the Navy and shot down a lot of planes in the Battle of Midway, and his name was O'Hare.
Oh, yeah.
Talked a lot about the trains and the bolts that came down and the streetcars, and when you dig up some of the streets in Chicago, you can still see the tracks.
Mm-hmm.
Is there places where there's still tracks in Lamont or in the forest preserves or is it just buried?
The tracks in Lamont ran right over the streets that are there now. So I'm sure it's been all torn up. So there wouldn't be a remnant somewhere else, as far as I know.
But I mean, they probably went through what is now the Forest Preserve, I'm guessing?
It really went right along Archer, sometimes right on the street.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, followed Archer. Yes?
I don't know if you can answer this or not,
That was the sanitary canal. Right. Right. Yeah, that's one of the things that, the picture doesn't show it all that well. What was interesting is that in the first picture I showed you that go back 13,000 years ago, the Valparaiso Moraine was actually a continental divide. And everything that was on the Lake Michigan side, including the Chicago River, at that time, flowed in the opposite direction. But everything there went into the Great Lakes, whereas the Des Plaines River, which formed on the opposite side of the moraine, went to the Mississippi. So that's why the way the rivers worked and the monumental things we did when we constructed that canal, and it really was a Chicago school of earth moving. I mean, we did just a marvelous thing. Now we can't even keep our potholes fixed.
Is that, is the moraine the same as the
Well, it would have been on the Continental Divide, but I don't think you could pinpoint it to an exact spot. I mean, it was wider than that, probably 4 or 5 miles, I would say, at least. Okay, I will have my books for sale here. If any of you would like to get autographed copies, I would be happy to sign them for you. And thank you all for coming.